I'll do it in two parts, and I promise it will be short. In fact, a lot shorter than Laura's the other night. In the end, I was laughing. Was that too long? I'm sorry, was it too long? That was good. That was fine. I don't know what you're laughing at. I'll do it in two parts, though. Both are short. One is the standard fare, and then the other is a couple of thoughts that I have, and they're personal, and so if Neil wants to argue with them, I hope that he will. Neil Spiller is Hawksmoor Chair of Architecture and Landscape and Deputy Pro-Vice-Chancellor. Deputy Pro-Vice-Chancellor of the University of Greenwich, London. Prior to this, he was Dean of the School of Architecture, Design, and Construction. And Professor of Architecture and Digital Theory at Greenwich University. Before this, he was Vice Dean and Graduate Director of Design at the Bartlett School of Architecture, University College London. He guest edited his first AD, of which several came after, many of which were influential to people like me, Architects in Cyberspace in 1995, followed in 1996 by Integrating Architecture, Architects in Cyberspace 2, 1998, Youngblood, 2000, Reflexive Architecture, 2002, Protocell Architecture, 2010, Drawing Architecture, 2013. Neil's numerous books, and these are not all of them, include Cyber Reader, Critical Readings of the Digital Era, 2002, Digital Dreams, The Architecture of the New Alchemic Technologies, 1998, and Visionary Architecture Blueprints of the Modern Imagination, 2006. He's on the AD editorial board. That shouldn't surprise you, given the numerous contributions that he's had to that particular journal. His architectural design work has been published and exhibited on many occasions worldwide. Since 1998, he has produced the epic Communicating Vessels project, and I'll mention that briefly in just a second. Neil was also known as the founding director of Avatar, which stands for Advanced Virtual and Technological Architectural Research Group. It's now based at the University of Greenwich. This group has a PhD and master's program and conducts research into advanced technologies and architectural representation, but more importantly, into the impact of advanced technologies such as virtuality and biotechnology on 21st century design. Neil and the Avatar Group are recognized internationally for their paradigm-shifting contribution to architectural discourse, research, experiment, and teaching. Now, I mentioned communicating vessels, which I don't think is the whole thing, but just to give us a target. Long and short, slow and fast. Like Michael Webb and Ben Nicholson, two other visionary architects I understand he admires a great deal, and I think I see why. I think we'll see why more as you speak. Neil has no problem whatsoever with the long project. The project that lasts for years, even decades sometimes, taking on various different permutations along the way. I don't even know if the kids know what that means, but I do. Ever since I got into ever since I got into architecture, I've heard more criticism of such projects than support for them. Critics and colleagues wanting each other to hurry up and get on with it. While I understand this to a degree, as much as I can, I've never liked it, I've never liked that, and have secretly always wished I had maybe been born 15 or 20 years earlier so I could have lived through a period when I think the long project had a larger and more sympathetic audience. I'd also observe here that I've noticed that in most cases when someone is saying something dismissive, which I hate, about the long project practitioner, I can tell that deep down they really admire him or her. Not just for the sheer talent these designers almost always possess, which is technically better than the rest in the field, almost always, but also for the courage it takes to forge the long vision over time. To my eye and mind, Neil ranks among the elite shortlist of such figures, and even so, there is at least one way he remains distinct from them. In those other cases, there is often this unspoken or, say, at most, spoken in hushed tones and whispers. There's this unspoken charge that the work is somehow out of time or out of place or both. Maybe this is sometimes true, but there is nothing anachronistic at all about Neil's approach to a long project. His role in the so-called digital project is proof of this. He established himself at the very beginning of that term, and he was established before that, but I'm just saying. He established himself at the very beginning of that term long before most of the rest of us who ever got involved with it, as one that could guide its work and discourse forward, all the while staying true to his own prior thinking. Strangely, part of the reason the digital project has moved so fast is directly related to Neil's writing and publication on that subject. How and why he did this, I don't really know, and hope to have a better understanding of that tonight. But whatever the reasons, I thank him for it, not just for his contributions to the digital project and especially his generosity toward my particular generation, but for how he seems to have made it possible to have a project both long and short, slow and fast. Please join me in welcoming Neil Spiller.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Jason. That was fantastic. You must be the only person who looks at my work. So thank you for that. You're very kind. If I ever wanted anyone to introduce me in the perfect way, you've just done it. So, I really appreciate that. The lecture is called Communicating Vessels. I've got 40 minutes, so it's not my usual all singing, all dancing thing. And you want me to talk about the school that we've built in Greenwich over the last couple of years, a few years. So it's in two halves. The first half is about Greenwich. That's the small half. The other half is about me. The important half. And the larger half. So this is where I live. We all live like this in England. This is the University of Greenwich. About 4 years ago, just nearly 5 years ago, I was sitting at the Bartlett in University College in my, as us English people do, in my gown. My port encrusted gown, and the phone had been ringing for a couple of days. We tend to take our time in England, and I picked it up, and there was the PA from an ex Labour minister for the arts who'd been one of Blair's babes in the Labour government, the terribly failed Labour government in the 90s. And she said, would you would you like to come to Greenwich? You know, I'm spending £78 million on a new building, and I'd like someone to get it all in order, really. And the School of Architecture then wasn't here. This is the headquarters of the University of Greenwich. It was in a terrible place in southeast London called Eltham, which I don't expect you to know anything about. And to have been languishing, the school had been languishing at the bottom of the league tables, if anything's, if league tables are important, and obviously they're not, but the bottom of the league tables for years. I mean, it was not the best school of architecture, and obviously I'm being videoed, so I can't tell you the truth. So it'll be all over the world, and then I'll have to come and talk to people about it and say I'm sorry and all that stuff. I agreed to come. The building hadn't been built. In fact, the building had planning permission at that point, and I arrived at the time. This is the building, not the sort of fairy cake thing. That's Hawksmoor, which I'm named after. That's the new building. And they said to me, oh, what would you like to be called? So I was Hawksmoor Chair, Deputy Pro Vice-Chancellor, Sir, stuff like that. I never thought they would. So this is the new building, just beating around Hawksmoor's St Alfred's Church, one of the great London churches of Hawksmoor. And we sit looking at it from this building. And this is it. And basically, it's the only School of Architecture on a World Heritage Site, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Can you imagine the trouble trying to elevate a building on a UNESCO World Heritage Site? Anyway, around it's mostly crap. but there was a lot of argy-bargy, as they say. And this is inside. The architects were Hennig & Peng, £78 million. I love Hennig & Peng. They are great. They're Harvard educated. They are great at handling the vicissitudes, I think, as I'm being videoed, universities. And they are fantastic. So the great thing about this building is that it's their precedents for it were obviously Paul Rudolph's Yale and whoever knocked up Harvard. I really have no idea who knocked up Harvard. And the thing about this building is it's not an obstacle. So it's just not an obstacle. So we can do whatever we want. We can hang cars every 2 meters from the ceiling, with lugs that are set into the concrete. It's got massive ceiling heights. It's got a sense of air and space. It's not an obstacle. So the first thing I would say about new schools of architecture is don't let them be obstacles. In a way, make them large spaces that you can 24-hour living toys, as one of my mentors, Cedric Price, said. There's 14 roof gardens. We have different mature landscapes like wetlands and stuff. We have landscape architecture with us. I was a graduate. Before it was called the University of Greenwich, it was also on a site 30 years ago, 35 years ago, called in Dartford, which was a ladies' PE college. I thank you. God, I thank you. But it also... when I wasn't watching ladies hockey on a cold day, landscape architecture and architects were taught together, and we still maintain that tradition. So we use our landscape roofs as ways of developing 21st century technologies like algae or aquaponics. So these are those roofs, very early on actually. So this is the World Heritage Site. You see where our site is next to the buffer zone, but on the main site. And you see the main old Royal Naval College, which is where the university is, which is the first picture I showed you. And it stretches across to the Isle of Dogs, where Henry VIII kept his hunting dogs. It was a palace, Henry's palace. Elizabeth I was born there. The world meridian, zero datum, comes through this site. So it's the history of space and time, technology, navigation is absolutely crucial to this site. And it was the home of the British Navy. So there you see our building set into the, it's the National Maritime Museum behind it. And what we've done is we've set up a whole series of different ways of looking. Universities can be very sort of weird about their logos, can't they? The University of Greenwich World, because I'm on the video, was not as good as it might be. And so we had to develop our own kind of corporate style. We had pop-ups, there's Simon Heron, son of Ron Heron, in a pop-up in Old Street. This is the inside. I've got to speed up if I'm going to get to me, the important bit. Some of the students' work. Some of the people who, Heron and me, I took about 10 members of staff out of the Bartlett when I came. And I say this with love, if anyone from the Bartlett is looking later. The radical arm of the Bartlett, I took. And this is some of their work. This is Nick Shapaniak, who go to the Bartlett, who also works for me. Robots of Brixton became a massive kind of controversial hit, which was the reenacting of the Brixton riots with animated robots, which won the RIBA Silver Medal in 2011. Nick Clear, who now heads up the architecture school, student. It's a bit blurred. Is that a bit blurred, or is it me? Anyway, we knock up this sort of stuff. It gets awards from the RIB, Royal Institute of British Architects. This was the Sargent Award for drawing around against 300 schools of architecture around the world in 2012. This is another RIBA prize, 2014. Our students go on working some of the most interesting practices, Rogers Foster, all sorts of practices around the world. Before I arrived, and I say it myself, before my team arrived, they were lucky if they ever got employed. No, it's true, look at the statistics. This is a new entrance for, let's call it a world-class football stadium in North London. which is likely to be built soon, which is one of our students on his year out. So we're getting there. Exhibitions, Outlook, before I arrived, and I think it's fair to say, anyone looking at the video, that they did diddly squat outside Southeast London. And so this is an exhibition in Bahrain. We're very good about getting our work out there. The important thing, as I've learned with my own work, as well as my colleagues' work, and that we need to be a global presence. And it's very important that you have a brand that architects understand. This may be different from the brand that universities understand. We have conferences, future cities, abundance, architecture and landscape. We just had one. We do installations. This was an attempt to build the largest paper house, 9 meters by 9 meters cubed, in the world. This is a mock-up. It blew away. However, it had fail-safe tears on it, so we didn't all end up down the Blackwall Tunnel. So we nearly got there. It caused some consternation in such an august position, but got us on the news 3 times, 3 months running. One's for the ambition, one's for putting it up, and two for the tearing. And we have an international lecture series. The School of Architecture cannot survive without engaging the discourse in the world. I obviously squeeze out a couple of books now again. And so do my colleagues, Mark Garcia, who used to be, I always say this, I shouldn't really, Nigel Coates' right-hand man at the RCA, and Nick Clear, who's the current head. And recently we've had a spate of ADs, Future Details, Patrick Schumacher and Ben Van Berkel in the keynotes. And educated architects, Neil Denari there, and Hernandez Alonso came and did the keynotes on separate days for our two-day conference, and UCLA is featured in that book. And what it's a very cunning thing, it's very cunning, it's one of those cunning ideas I have every now and again when I'm not drinking, which is, let's place ourselves on the top table of architecture schools. So who do we want? We want UCLA, we want SciArc, we want the AA, we want the Bartlett, we want the Angavanga, we want a couple of places in China, couldn't say which ones, and we want Keeper, we want, you know, blah, blah, blah. And it worked, and it was great, and we had a lovely time, and I think we all learned stuff from each other. So top schools of architecture need to do this continuously. I also host the Hawksmoor International Lecture Series, and in recent months we've had partners in Foster's, we've had Michael Palin's son, who's in charge of from Monty Python, in charge of conservation in the old Royal Naval College. We've had Beatrice Colomina. We've hosted the Landscape Institute Annual General Meeting. We've had CJ Lim on drums. and this is some of the work that the students do at undergrad. It's just stuff, really, isn't it? You know, but the thing is, drawing, that's the first point. Drawing. Do not give up drawing. It's through drawing that you put ideas into your mind and into your head, and withdrawing that you manipulate them. It seems to me. Anyway, stuff, undergraduate stuff. We get them to do little models of details and stuff. One of the things that we wanted to do with the school was to get it to be pragmatic, so that students came out with some pragmatic skills, which made them employable, but also, and I've just been watching Hitoshi's new video, which maybe you haven't seen yet, which also, Greg talks in it about preparing architects for the next generation for 10 years hence in practice. And that's the important thing that we have to do. Make them oven-ready turkeys, but also that turkey is going to dance in 10 years' time. So construction is very, very important, because it's through understanding construction that we can manipulate our spaces and create an understanding of what might constitute architecture in the 21st century and the impact of advanced technologies on it. If we don't understand what construction is to begin with in the 20th century paradigm, we'll never develop the 21st century paradigm, it seems to me. We also get students to write. The vast majority of architects spend a lot of time writing reports, and to do that you need a creative mind. Anyway, postgraduate stuff. A bit more computer there, drawing. Each student has to do, under the RIBA and our criteria, we have to do a postgrad and undergrad, but postgrad particularly, what we call design realisation. It's something that we invented at the Bartlett and took with us to Greenwich, and it means that every fourth year student has to produce a mediumly complex building and detail it down to the foundations. This gives them power, and it also makes them employable for the moment. Anyway, some of the practices that we work with, and each week we reach out to the practices. Some of the best architects in London or some of the best engineers in London work with us, either as technical consultants or indeed run units. We have Will Alsop running a unit, and we have Alfred Hall Monaghan and Morris, got this side of the pond, quite in such force as they are on the other side of the pond. The Avatar Group, as mentioned, it's also a clear part of a clear component of this. Anyway, when are we going to get to me? Wish you were here. Yep. The ducks, they all moved in. Yeah. The island shaped like a puppy. Yeah. Anyway, me. In 1985, I also went. The University of Greenwich was then called the Thames Polytechnic. One of the things that makes me weird is I graduated from Thames Polytechnic in 1984. It was in Dartford, obviously, and there's a lot of, as I mentioned, the PE girls. But one of the things I did for my final project was a School of Architecture for the Architectural Association in Covent Garden on the Floral Hall site, and it was built around the Seven Lamps of Architecture, which was my bag at the time. And this is life or sacrifice or God knows what. Anyway, there were about 50 drawings and they looked all vaguely like this. And it was a school of architecture, so you'd have studios and you'd have a communal space and blah, blah, blah. And here's another one. It's kind of post-punk. Post-punk, so I was looking at Nigel Coates and the NATO group and all sorts of stuff. And in fact, I suspect probably what my idea was that schools of architecture change by the kind of accretions that they have in them. And over the years, things are accreted on top of other things. So that was that. I mean, those are the drawings of a naive young man. I'm probably creating more obstacles than opportunities, but there you are. Of course, facilities management at the University of Greenwich wouldn't allow such a thing. Stones in the floor and God knows what. But, anyway, the entrance of this architecture school was what I called the Dorian Gray column, which was a column that you're supposed to, the students were to dress up, so over the generations it would change. God, it would be interesting to speculate what it would be now. It would be a lot more blobby, I guess. So the Dorian Gray column is a kind of motif in my work. And stands in for perhaps the fickle fashion of architectural style. So, in 2008, I wrote a thing that's conditioned. Don't worry, it's okay. The Seven Continuum Post-Digital Architecture. And this really is not just about my work, but about the sort of school that we're creating. The school that we're creating isn't there yet. There's still a lot more to do. And in my opinion, we need to explore more of these continua. So the first continua is technology. So we all know that we can use a Victorian cog as an architect, a can, a valve, a capacitor, a logic gate, an integrated circuit, a CPU, a quantum computer, a stem cell, a nanobot, and a million states and applications between. So there's a continuum that we can use as architects. There's a second continuum of narrative, semiotics, and performance. An architectural designer can choose whether their work operates along a continuum that ranges from minimal engagement in quotation or mnemonics or reference to the history of culture or the contemporary world, or embraces the multiplicity of the complex and emergent universes of discourse that we inhabit and engage with daily. So that's another continuum. So consider this as all being a series of sliders on a mixing desk. So cyborgian geography is another. A designer can now posit work that operates in all manner of mixed and augmented terrains, that are subject to all manner of geomorphic and cybermorphic factors and drivers. Scopic regimes, which I need from Martin J. Architecture can exist at all scales, depending on the resolution of the scope that one chooses to use. Continents, oceans, cities, streets, rooms, carpets, micro-landscapes, and medico-landscapes are all part of this continuum. Another continuum, sensitivity. A designer might decide to make objects, spaces or buildings with parts that are sensitive to and pick up environmental variations or receive information. These sensors can therefore make objects and buildings that are influenced by events elsewhere, or indeed are influential elsewhere. And the final one, the big one, time. This is the most important part of these continua. All the above six that I've mentioned previously are time dependent, so we can move the sliders on the dial, not just with one project and stick them there, but move them over time within one project. And that's absolutely crucial. So to try and teach young people about that, I think is crucial. And that's what this school, my school's about. One of the things that's also important is to celebrate difference and the fact that we can't make events the same. So here's Robert Rauschenberg, can't remember what it is, maybe it's 1938, Factum 1, Factum 2. So it's about trying to make the same painting twice. And obviously, he can't. And we have to understand as architects that we can't either. I'm a huge fan of Marcel Duchamp and the large glass. And again, architectures of desire are also important. When you talk to young people, they don't seem to want to discuss desire or memory. This is Alfred Jarry, the inventor or creator of pataphysics and Per Ubu. Play that was performed in Paris in 1896. It's caused a riot. And he created pataphysics, very knowledgeable. He died at something like 36, allegedly through ether and absinthe poisoning. Most of modern literature comes out of Alfred Jarry through Joyce and Beckett. Subsequently. There are three declensions of pataphysics, and this is what the Communicating Vessels Project is all about. One is anomaly, bringing together disparate things. Two is hybridity. Three is, what Jarry would call syzygia, where three planets align for a moment. And the final one is Clinamen, which comes from Lucretius, which is the swerve of an atom falling to the ground to create matter. So it's the swerve that's very important, and these were grounding principles of surrealism. So on one level, I'm trying to create, in my work, but equally in the work of the school, and we're not there yet, the first surrealist school of architecture that embodies the impact of 21st century architecture, our technologies on its architecture. Anyway, the Communicating Vessels project is based on a kind of psychedelic geographic island, which you can see there, the fork of the River Stour, in a place called Fordwich near a village I was brought up. I used to ride my bike around it, both actually and metaphorically. Now, all the pieces that I will show you are not geographically. There's more stuff on the island than could actually fit on. So it's kind of half there. It's psychogeographical, it's mnemonic, it's also actual. Anyway, the actual island looks like that. It's very nice, river stour, very beautiful. So this isn't a project against nature, it's a project that's something else altogether. So the first bit, so the communicating vessels is obviously a quote from André Breton. So it's surreal, it's personal, it's been a long-running project. It started in 1998. There's a series of objects that communicate. Some of them are off the island and have inputs into the island. Some of them have outputs off the island. And one of them that I wanted to show you, just to set up the kind of thing, is the D-stools. The D-stools, there's about six of them, sitting on the riverbank. And they're small boxes. They're small, about three buttocks wide. For symmetry. And inside a D-stool, they are miniature astrophysical laboratories. And if you sit on the outside of the D-stool, on the bicycle seat on the top, they'll vibrate. When they vibrate for the first time, they create a planting plan. So inside each D-stool are a series of objects, five artificial lips, a ready-made bicycle wheel, a clinamen, which is a painting machine, a draft piston, something from Swift's gearage in the academy, some dishirico pieces, a cucumber, and an alembic. So the perspective of that looks like this, and you can see. So it's a kind of painting machine, but it's also confined, and there's a series of references. So there's an actual terrain, and there's a kind of, let's call it, a virtual augmented reality terrain, which flows through the box, and it's a kind of planting plan. So first time you see it on the box, the painting machine goes off, and it hits different areas of this fluctuating landscape, virtual landscape that goes through, and it remixes surrealist poetry, but equally it determines various bits for a planting plan, which happens on the island. So it floods through this box out the funnel over the sewing machine, and because it's beautiful. And you get vectors like this, and there's various inputs and outputs, and there's Velasquez machines based in Paris and God knows what. And there's parallaxes, which are the kind of black canoe-shaped things, and time-based visions, and things that occupy the parallax of one viewer relative to another, all in this kind of aerogel kind of bower. And where the vistas go out over the river, there's this kind of aerogel gates, kind of heavy metal Art Nouveau gates, in a way that, like cigarette smoke, will just drift away. This is the Velasquez machine in Monet's elliptical galleries in the Tuileries Gardens in Paris, a great perturbation in art, where art goes from purely representational to abstract. It's caught, the water lilies are both representational but also abstract. And this is a machine that shakes itself apart within that, linked up to the internet. And artists and architects' narcissism. And also generate some of the planting plan. I'm going through this quite quickly. And there are various bits to that. Another input engine for the VISTA is some measuring devices in the Tempietto in Rome, which is now part of the Spanish embassy, in the flowering of the Renaissance, Italian Renaissance, 1505, something like that. And architecture is all about tolerances. With classical proportion, you can map out how tall something should be, but you're always dependent on the stonemason to get it roughly right. And there's always a digression. That's a minor tolerance. But actually, Bramante wanted this radial courtyard around it, and what was that eventually built was a square one. So there are bigger tolerances, and those tolerances through these measuring sticks are making velocities of objects around that vista I just showed you. So this is just a small bit of it. And some of those velocities are channeled into these sculptures. When you set up a vista, you need a start point and you need something for it to finish on. But these sculptures are mobile. This is a kind of homage to Salvador Dali and his paranoid critical method, and Hector Guimard's lamps, and God knows what. There's a lot of stuff going on. I show that because I like it. Dura, the Dance of Death. You know, I talked about those pieces in those kind of canoe, black canoe things on the plan. And the idea was that if you could see the wheelbarrow with expanding bread, then in that zone that someone else couldn't see, there would appear something else. And it was kind of like a dance of death, which is a standard medieval thing where no matter how pious you are, there's always death pulling on your t-shirt arm, saying, you're rich, you're poor, you're pious, you're this, that, and the other, but you're going to die soon. So what have you really added to the world? And so I wanted something to appear in those kind of canoe zones in parallax, depending on viewers. And this is Dora Maar's 1939 picture of Père Ubu, which is Jarry's major character. She was obviously a mistress of Picasso. Our old mate, Le Corbusier, in the 1950s, he started to produce a long series of sculptures and drawings called Ubu. So I put it to you that Le Corbusier was one of us. The genetic gazebo, another piece on the island that channels the DNA of insects caught in amber and makes planting plants in a small gazebo that exists. And it uses sort of Gordon Pass conversation theory, the idea of self-wiring systems, and all manner of other things. Dendritic systems, these are some contemporary ones. I realise I'm going through quite fast, but... And that's a plan of the genetic gazebo. Various inputs, various bits and pieces going on. And it sits on this weir and takes some of the power for its computational ability from a large thing that sits on that. There you are, with a large neoprene tie that just bubbles around all the way. Because we've got to be sustainable, haven't we, now? Like all good surrealists, the person who owns the island in the narrative is called the Professor, who's nothing like me. And he has a chess set. This is a queen. Some pawns, a queen, a king, a baroness. The whole island is activated by Greece. And Greece is the kind of fiery, biotechnical fluid that drives all the pieces on the island. So here's two knights back to back. There's another character on the island called the Baroness. The Baroness sees everything. And like in the large glass, the bride has electronic filaments, and likewise the Baroness does. And here you see some electronic filaments going out across a vista, sensing where the sculptures are. Because what she needs more than anything else is Greece. And here is one of my favourites, which has a long title, which is Wheelbarrow with Expanding Breads, Bulb Being Caressed by a Filament Under the Disapproving Eye of a Wasp. So one of the other pieces, and I think I'll stop after this piece, I was a very good friend of Lebius Wood's, and when Lebius died in 2012, I had realised that I wanted to make part of the Communicating Vessels project a walled garden. And so the walled garden became the walled garden for Lebius. And this is the simple plan. And I wanted it to have an augmented reality component. So I'm very much into this kind of combination of what we see and the informational structures around us. So this is what you would see. It's a little walled garden. And at the end of the walled garden is a sculpture called Electra. And if you push your face into the back of her face, into the hollowed out face, and look through her eyes and listen through her ears, you would see an amazing thing, which is an augmented reality storm coming over the walled garden, little memorial walled garden. And of course it quotes Aldo Rossi and various other people. And so we end up with these kind of weather patterns across, and gravity gradients across the garden, focusing around the kind of little fustrum, which is the truncated cone. And there's a snowstorm that comes as well. So the drawings are at once a kind of homage to Lebius, but also a kind of new beginning that talks about a variety of technologies that, and how we might use drawing and computers to develop new terrains for architecture to exist in. Some of the pieces, there are kind of ghosts in the garden as well, and one of them is the Dorian Gray column, which is kind of formed and reconformed out of vectors. And waxes and wanes. Another motif from the project, which I haven't had time to talk to you about, the turd-like object and the meter and various other pieces. So the whole project really is a kind of memory theatre that plays off the history of surrealism. Since Jason, I'm getting near my 40 minutes, is that right? Aren't you?
You can go on and on, as far as
I'm concerned. So here you see the start of the new dawn, it subsides. You see the sculpture, the start of the new dawn. Snow, the virtual snow abating. You see the frustrum, the truncated cone across the water. turbulence in the water. As Jason's been so nice, I'll show you something else. I'll show you something else that's related to these last bits and pieces, all related to Pelagius Garden. Arnold Bocklin was a big influence on Giorgio di Chirico, and this is the Island of Death, which he did various versions of, I think 6 or 7. And people like Andy Warhol and H.R. Geiger also did versions of this. But you get here this kind of enigma, this silent enigma. Something terrible has happened. We're not sure whether the figure in white is dead, alive, or what. And I like that, and that was a major thing, a major influence on de Chirico. If we go to something, I think it was 1938 to 1932, Giacometti's The Palace at 4 a.m. The figure of the mother, the figure of the girlfriend, the bird, these represented by the kind of pod-like thing in the middle. And some people have seen the spine, the truncated spine-like object, as a phallus dentata. I'm just telling you how. Just so you know. So it comes in handy. And why the fustrum? The fustrum, 1913 in Herne Bay, allegedly, which is just round the corner from my island, Marcel Duchamp did the first pictures of the bride for the large glass. He was staying in Herne Bay, chaperoning his sister who was learning anglais. And this is the sex cylinder, and it's a truncated cone. So it seems to me there's a, in my next book I'll be writing, I think, about the truncated cone as a kind of figment at the beginning of modernism that allowed us to a kind of signal of the beginning of modernism. It might just be me. And obviously, Piranesi, the ninth plate in the second edition of the Carceri, which Tafori's been written about. I like that thing. So I'm starting to show you now what's in the fustrum in the Lebes Garden. And I wanted to quote all these things. So I started to do some drawings about what was in the top. There are two chambers in the top of the fustrum. This is the top chamber. And here you see the augmented reality storm passing over the top of the hollow cone. And the figure of the mother. The more you look into the eyes of the statue, the more the storms happen, and the more the figure of the mother keeps going like a Swiss clock in and out of the black doorway. And here in 1914 you see Man Ray. Again, fustrums. But also here, Leader and the Swan. Leader and the Swan is very, very important. Symbolic story for the Surrealists. And here's a 1920s one. And you know, we're all aware of W.B. Yeats' wonderful poem, Leader and the Swan, in which the swan is often depicted, whether the swan, which I think is Zeus, seduces Leader, or whether he rapes her. That upset the Vice-Chancellor. And Surrealists have really gone for this, and even later, kind of Surrealist magic realism, people like Andrew Carter have really gone for this kind of motif. Here we have de Chirico, the return of Ulysses. So the room becomes both outside and inside and mixes the scales. Or we have Dorothea Tanning from 1970, room 202, Hotel du Pavot. I thought. My French accent's not very good because I was educated in the 70s in England. And the choice was technical drawing or French. I did technical drawing and failed it. So in the bottom half of the frustrate is this kind of space of blackness, full of grease. And as the backwards and forwards happens, the space starts to configure itself into a form. And that form is Leader in the Swamp. To stop there. Thank you very much. Just broken your microphone. Right. Showed you all of it, of course. You're very kind. Do you need this? Or is this adding an asymmetry?
I had a plan beforehand. You began your talking about it would be half knowledge, half knowledge. And you kind of did that. I'm not sure if you really did that, but I noticed that the half Greenwich was very, very funny. And I want to talk about that. And that was my whole plan, was to talk about humor and architecture right off the bat, but I can't now. The half meal that wasn't so funny. Or maybe we'll get to the point where maybe it is funny and you can tell us how it is. But I can't help but when I was thinking about your work, you know, I can't help but think about Lendius Wood. And toward the end, that's where you go. What's that all about?
The whole Lendius thing. Lendius was very, very kind to me for many, many years. I mean, he was, when we did, for example, and this was fairly recently, the AD for drawing architecture, he was the referee. You know, they sent me out to an external referee. But I've known Lendius since 1990 and have met him in various places around the world. And he'd always been very appreciative of my work, actually, as well as, you know, that's reciprocated, obviously, but he always went out of his way to help me along the way, in a way. About a year before he died, I got an email. We would email and see each other every now and again. And it said, "What are you doing? I miss you." Which was nice. But also he published stuff on his blog a couple of times. And so he was always a kind of larger-than-life hero for me. Like three others, really. I mean, Peter Cook's a larger-than-life hero. He's the only one left, and Sir Price, who also was very kind to me. So I've been lucky to be kind of, I don't know whether mentored is the right expression. I think in Peter's case it probably is. By those three, so I thank my lucky stars.
Well, I don't mean to dwell on what I said in the introduction. introduction, because I really want to talk about humor, and then I'd love to talk about post-profit architecture school and the rest of it, and we'll see what the rest of them do. But it struck me, because when I was thinking about your work in preparation for all of this, as I said, Lebius can't help but come up in my mind, and I'll just be very honest with you. When I was for whatever reason, and I think it's just age, you know, Lebius was teaching at Sion. I went to Sion, and Lebius was teaching there at the time as well as other places. And that whole thing that I said in the beginning about the long project, like Lebius's project was a long, long,
absolutely
long project. And the one sentence I said, I think, about certain critics being dismissive of the long project, I couldn't help but notice that when Lebius Woods died recently, all that went away. And I have to say, I was very irritated with that. Well, how dare you? Not you. I mean, how dare they? And I wasn't even a huge fan. Like, I don't know Lebius. I didn't know Lebius Woods. My work doesn't have anything to do with Lebius Woods' work. But I had obviously respect for the long project. I didn't like that one bit when he passed, and immediately there was all kinds of accolades, as if no one ever said anything about the problem with the long project. Do you want to say anything about that, or we can just go on?
No, it's an interesting thought. I mean, you know, the best thing that ever happened to Jimi Hendrix, for example, is dying. It helps. I'm looking forward to it myself.
Sound like me now.
No. The long project, I mean, for me, the things that have most moved me in architecture are projects that are outside the realm of capitalism. So Mike Webb's Temple Island, which you mentioned, Lieberskin's Chamber Works, Micro Megas, you know, which I kind of put everything up until the Jewish Museum, and including the Jewish Museum as kind of a project, which I love. Cedric Price's Thumb Palace, or Peter Cook's trajectory through, you know, numerous ideas. And I like that. I like that. I mean, that's probably a dead end, in a way. But it's the kind of intellectual engagement. Some, I think, are more intellectually engaged than others, I think, in retrospect. But I like that kind of, everything needs to be so fast now. I've got a client, boom, boom, boom. Build the fucker. Or not, in which case, get another client, build the fucker. And it's never been my thing. Although that's not to say that I've not built stuff. I've built quite a lot of stuff, but not within my sort of parameters of extremes. But so it's not that I'm shying away. Peter Cook always said to me, you know, you're like Ron Heron. One day you'll want to build again. And I go, yeah, do you think? I'm not sure. Maybe. I always say, well, you know, I'd happily build if someone comes along with me. Right, Neil, build us some of your island and I'll pay millions and millions of dollars. And I promise not to irritate you. So maybe there's someone in the audience.
All that sounds very post-punk, but the post-punk is also not funny. So you started your life, so we'll get to that, because I want to pick up on your whole rhythm. You start really funny, and it's not that funny. So I wrote down here, read along with me, I don't think I like the way you English take advantage of your accent.
Well, in a good way.
So funny.
In a good way or a bad way? We do take advantage of both.
But one thing I don't think, and here's the second question, and I actually, this is very serious, One thing I don't think American designers don't always understand, and this includes me, is what's so funny about architecture, and why are English architects always making jokes?
Making jokes. I think architecture is fundamentally funny because it gives architects the ability to be so serious about themselves, and so if they are serious about themselves, they find that the English ones tend to find the necessity to make jokes to cover up how serious they are. Or there's another type of architect in England, I think, mainly those in schools, I guess, who just find the whole capitalist imperative of architecture ridiculously funny.
So are you saying that the funniest architect is the smartest architect, and the least funny architect is the not smartest, or the dumbest architect?
No, I don't know.
I wish you would say that.
No, it's tempting though. It's tempting.
No, because somebody needs to say it, but that's not what you're saying.
Some of the best architects are not funny at all. They're kind of scary. I couldn't possibly say. Most of those.
What is a surrealist school of architecture?
Well,
what does that look like?
What I wanted to do was try and... the important thing to say is that there are other people that I brought with me to make this school who would go, Neil's talking about fucking surrealism again, oh no. Abroad as well.
Yes. We don't talk about surrealism here, I don't think.
Well, my basic thesis is that there's a kind of surrealism then, which we all know about, Salvador Dali, Max Ernst, and all those things, and there's a world that we're entering, or that we're already in, that is fundamentally surrealist because of its impact on advanced technologies. So it's a world surreal, sir, on top of the real. And that's where you get augmented realities and virtual realities and all sorts of stuff. And it seems to me that some of those lessons that might be learned from surrealism in the 20s and 30s are not being learned at the beginning of the 21st century, or used in any significant way. So that's what I wanted to do. So there was another thing that's slightly, I was going to use the word orthogonal from traditional modernist thinking, although it is a modernist kind of trait. But it's much more heavy in a kind of psychosexual thing, semiotic thing. So that's what interested me about that. So when you talk about the first part of the... I suppose the first part of the talk, yes, was funny because it's something we can all empathise with, which is the tyranny of universities and how they can be ridiculously funny and dangerous to ideas and people. And the other part, which is probably much more to do with a kind of desiring, yearning, need to actually set down a series of parameters with which to operate personally as an architect.
Can you say anything more specifically about what a surreal school of architecture might look like? And if you don't want to, that's fine. But and then I have one other.
What I wanted to do is for everyone to understand symbolism and semiotics. I think so much of what we do is kind of placeless anymore. It doesn't sort of fit into channels of thought, channels of kind of intellectual endeavor. So, you know, I'm always saying to a student, do you know about this? Have you heard of Alvar Aalto? I don't know, how do you spell that? You're fucking post-grad. Yeah. Where have I been? Oh, I went to the Bartlett. No. They would at least know how to spell it. You know, so there's this whole history of architecture that people don't know. And that's, the canon is a long and glorious canon and can be very, very complex, but it's vitally important that architects know about it. So in a way, that's not necessarily surrealist, but it does give you an armory of possibilities for using those references to be subversive, to talk about the impact of 21st century technology, or to use the way that those architectures have been depicted in the past, might also be part of your canon. I also think that there's a symbiosis that we're not, going back to the seven continua, which was the least funny bit, was it? No, it's my greatest hit. People like it because it's not sort of weird. I'm getting that drift now. So the idea was that we could start moving stuff around those continua and develop. I think at the moment what we're doing is we're using digital technology to fabricate things, and that's part of the continua, obviously. And we're actually investing a lot of time in that. Some very interesting work's being done in that arena, but there's this whole other sort of areas that we're not kind of exploring in the fitness landscape. And that was my point, really. And some of those will be quite surreal, but in a new kind of way. I can't really define this kind of new surrealism, but it's different.
No, I'm just going to strike what I was going to ask. Last thing for me, unless I decide otherwise, is that what you're calling for? Because you have been, as I said before, such a huge supporter and advocate and fast intellect on the, for better or worse, name the digital project. Is that what you would call for then, as a kind of surreal impulse, as opposed to what, I won't say anymore, but as opposed to what's happening at this time?
The first book I really wrote, which got to the States, but I'm not. Just after Architects in Cyberspace, and just before the beginning of Architects in Cyberspace 2, I wrote a book called Digital Dreams. And Digital Dreams was published by a relatively small publisher in London called Ellipsis, and was picked up by the Whitney Museum in the States, I guess in New York. And that book really was way out there. It was written mostly, it took me ages to get it published. It was written from about 1992 to 95, 96, and had all sorts of surreal ideas about advanced technology, nanotech, virtuality, biotech, and depicted a very surreal world, I think. Which is, in the intervening 20 years, I think, has proved, whilst the way that I visualised it has obviously not come to pass, and one wouldn't imagine even then when I wrote it that it would, also describes some of that unharvested fitness landscape. So there's always been this kind of surreal impulse, this quite wacky impulse, and that's round about that time when that book was published in 1998, the communicating vessels, the big project then was, what do I do now? And it seemed to me one of the things that I needed to do was try to draw some of the things I've written about and some of the things I haven't written about. And to set in train a project that would allow me to continue probably for till my dying day, in a way. And then there's, I've said to people over the years, what happens? How do I know when it's finished? Well, maybe it's not finished now. maybe you put a bit under your bed that's discovered after you're dead, like Duchamp. Or, you know, maybe. But there always seems to be another iteration. Once a bit's finished, another bit comes to mind, and I know it fits in a way. So now there's about 450 drawings, thousands of words of prose, poetry, polemic invective, which I've only shown you a small amount. neilspiller.com. And that's only the tip of the iceberg as well, but it does show a bit more than I showed tonight. But and it is, it's very much, someone's also said to me recently, if the whole of human architectural culture disappeared overnight in some terrible catastrophe, what would we save? And he said very nicely, maybe it would be the communicating vessels, because you could take the kind of DNA of architectural discourse and the history of architectural discourse and how it relates to the history of art and kind of extrapolate outwards, which is very nice. It doesn't do that, obviously, but one can only hope.
I have lots more, but we should hear from the audience. Are there questions? I'm sure there are.
First of all, thank you, that was really excellent. But I had another question, I'm sorry, about surrealism. Can we use the term surreal in some context? Like, it was very similar to things that I've like heard or read in the past, only that instead of using the term surreal or on top of the real, it would be hyper-real or simulation. So I was wondering if you could explain that, if you think there's a distinction between sort of like hyper-real or simulation and surreal and what that is.
It's a difficult one, that. I mean, hyperreal reminds me of those two ADs that ripped me off in the 90s that bloke from Columbia did. There you are, you'll be in more trouble than me. So that hyperreal thing, and it sort of, you know, chimes with Umberto Eco and stuff like that. That's never been my thing. Simulation, I think, is part of those continua, really. You know, you push one dial up to the end, you get full-bodied virtual, full-bodily immersion in virtual reality, and it's everything's a simulation, really. So I just see them as elements of hyperreal. I don't really understand. I just see them as combinations of virtual, actual, biotech, medical landscape, scopic regime. You know, everything's a kind of mixing test. So it's kind of, what do you young people call it? Is it dubstep? Is that using my accent again? But at least I've got a trick. But that, you know, mixing stuff together, and obviously that comes from people like William Burroughs and, you know, the cut-up novels and various other things. Jeff Noon, I'm a big fan of, who also does it in a kind of contemporary way. So surreal, just... When I'm currently writing a book for Thames and Hudson on, it's called, well, the working title, whether they let me get away with it, it's called Blistering Romance, Surrealist Architecture Then and Now. Blistering Romance comes from my favourite musician, Zodiac Mindwalk, and he rants down his microphone about all sorts of stuff, a lot of it nasty, but... He just has a wonderful turn of phrase, blistering romance. So it's, you know, it's desire, but it's kind of a whole other kind of thing, kind of hyper-real, if you like. And so when my first book proposal went in, they just had a new management at Thames and Hudson, and the advice came back, oh, there's someone who's French on the board. Denied that there is no such thing as surrealist architecture. It's a literary movement. I learned it at the Sorbonne. You know, architects appropriating, blah, blah, blah. You know, could I change the proposal with that? And so it's blistering romance, surrealism, and architecture then and now, which seemed to get through, and as long as I put a sort of thing at the front saying, obviously, surrealism is a literary movement, and if you, you know, and I'm very sorry, and so that seemed to work. So, yeah, I mean, there's a kind of, I think it's down for us to start to define what this new surrealism is. But, you know, we live in a world where our homes are kind of optical machines into all sorts of things. You know, I can hold up a, what do you call them, phones, and I can see the night stars, or I can look at Australia's stars, or, you know, so easily. And that's a kind of reality on top of our actual reality. It's a kind of surrealism in a way. That's a kind of simple example. You know, I can activate reflexively machines thousands of miles away, or on the moon, or on Mars. I can do all sorts of things. I can land a satellite, or a, it's not a satellite, is it? A little thingy on a comet. I can do all sorts of stuff. You know, it depends on the scope of the regime. I'm looking through a telescope, I can look at, through a microscope, a scanning tunneling microscope, or whatever. There's our world. One of my favorite statistics, and then I'll shut up, is that if you, someone told me, and it may or may not be true, that if you take a whole human life of someone who died in 1900, and everything they felt, saw, experienced, and called it one unit, then in the year 2000, we were all living 10,000 units. So God knows where that is now. And it's exponential. And that's the modern condition. And that's what I'm interested in. I'm not interested in how many people buy Prada, or how fast the Pearl Delta expands. I'm interested in that basic fact and how weird that is.
I'm not sure I know how to ask this, mostly because I think that your work has, for my critical method, has really overtaken me to even articulate something or to draw some kind of conclusion or form a question. So I'm going to take a stab at it. But I guess what I'm curious about, it just seems that at least I think that students usually benefit in their work from using post-rational, like rationalizing drawings in the project in general. So the question might be more about the long project, but also when you're talking about tucking it under the bed, when I think about the island, for example, it's going to grow. Do you revisit it as it's in process? And I can't help but think also when you're referencing this idea of reusing sort of a visual culture of architectural tropes, Durand's column, things like that, that are sort of your own tropes that you're working for as well, as things we identify with. To see the Jurassic Park amber and to think about the fact that it's like, are you attempting to congeal the mosquito? I'm just sort of curious about sort of both those. Like, it's an afterlife sort of question, the post-rationalization. Maybe it doesn't exist in your work at all because it's always going, it's never cooked.
Yeah, it's always going. The bits are cooked. There's a lot of post-rationalization. When I do a piece, I start working on it, and then I reread it. It does. It's not a radical shift, but the drawing or the mistakes in the drawing help me articulate the kind of intellectual details of the thing. So I like rereading the basic intellectual agendas there. Then there's a drawing. And then the drawing is scanned and reread in both senses and rearticulated and sometimes collaged or layered or a bit's taken and expanded and redrawn out of the machine and then in the machine. What I try to do with the work is also I don't want you to know how I've made it. Sometimes in the earlier work it's just pen and ink, but and that's important because I think it's also important to be a bit of a magician nowadays, and there's so little magic left. So yes, the post-rationalization. I mean, keeping things in aspect. I mean, in aspect is also another important thing. I mean, the island, the Communicating Vessels project, is really my memory theatre. It's where I've been intellectually, in a way. And whilst I don't find any need to leave it there for posterity so people can see where I've been, it's also important for me to understand where I've been. One of the wackiest and nicest things that anyone, and Jason was right, I am a big fan of Ben Nicholson and his complete madness. And he said to me one day, his drawing, it was about 2002 when I went to see him in Chicago, and he was drawing every labyrinth beautifully, and I think that was exhibited at the Venice Biennale in the end. And the drawings were fantastic, and that boy can really draw. And I said to him over a whiskey later, I said, Ben, why are you doing this thing? And he looked at me with that manic smile, and he went, because I want to know what it feels like. And that's why I did what I did, because I want to know what it feels like.
Maybe behind this, because if you also parse out a number of moments or comments, there are generational bombs being tossed, right?
Yeah.
Students have a loss of memory, and I think of Godard's newest film on language, and yet he makes a plea for what does it mean to be deeply human. Ballard did. To a certain extent, Joy Division did, and the surrealists. What does it mean to be deeply human? Or Foster Wallace, who was not a surrealist and just a postmodernist and played a little bit with words. But I sense, on the one hand, a melancholy that, on the one hand, also the surrealist project was about, you know, vaginas instead of mouths, and sewing machines on bicycles, and on and on, and against interpretation, and that if anything's hyper-real today for us, it's just merely banal for a young audience, right? Immediacy and communication, right? We in our generation can find shock and displacement where there's only a generation inured, on the one hand, to what. So I sense that by bringing your team from the Bartlett and your own work, that what's lacking today is not only humanity, but you know, a project partly of resistance, just in the commercial sense, but also of the radical, and the radical still does involve sewing machines on bicycles and vaginas for mouths and so forth. And I guess at the end of the day, I wonder how it is that gets put across, not in the terms of the melancholy. And I want to kind of draw that out, because a little bit is about teaching today is about crossing generational divides, where students have expertise in a funny way that we don't. Whether it's about they understand the banal and we think it's spectacular, or right, there's cross-generational problems. Can you just talk a little bit more about that?
I've always tried to couch what I do and what I want the school to do in terms of the impact of advanced technologies in the 21st century. And you're right, the idea of seeing the stars through the phone, you know, blows my mind. But to a 21-year-old, that's stars, mate. You know, stars, stars through my leg. You're right. What I try to do with my students is try to get them to engage in the world as a journey of spectacular occurrences, in a way. And this is amazing, this is great. There's an amazing material, and it's, you know, shape memory, or there's a robot, or there's a, I could do this. And what disturbs me often, and this is where the melancholy comes in, I think, is that so few students actually grab the baton and go, "Wee!" You know, and show me something that I've never seen before. So on a one level, I suppose I'm a kind of image addict, or a form addict, or show me something I haven't seen before. You know, let me help you, you know, show me something I haven't seen before. I want new. And that seldom happens. However, every now and again, it happens in spades. Every 5 or 6 years, there'll be 5 students who come along and show me 5 different things I'd never thought I'd see. But it might be 5 years till the next bus comes along. So there is a melancholy. There is a melancholy in the Communicating Vessels project about the loneliness of that knowledge, in a way. That's often been mostly forgotten, in a way. And I'm not saying that there's, you know, loads of surrealist historians. There's probably not that many, but I used to enjoy going to, there used to be a thing, the government gave some money a few years ago to the Surrealism and its Legacies group, which are arts historians from the Courtauld in London, or Cambridge, or University of Manchester, or University of Essex. And they used to have an event down in Edward James's West Dean country pile down in Chichester. And they used to love me because I was alive. It's great, isn't it? I'm just alive. You know, I can talk about surrealism and I'm alive. Slam dunk, I believe the expression is. But obviously, you know, and there's a lot of sort of talk about what artists are, surrealist in a way. If you take Jake Demas Chapman or Letitia, Tacita Dean, yes, Tacita Dean, you know, with her films of the Kodak stuff. I don't know what got me onto that. But there's a melancholy there, like there is in that film, actually, the kind of Kodak factory. And so, yes, there is this kind of sense of passing time, I think, which I think is to do with my age, the fact that I've now been teaching architecture for 25, 30 years, not quite 30 years. And things have changed so radically. So, you know, when we say to students, look, in your lifetime, things are going to change even faster, I think that's totally true. it's been an extraordinary change in mine and Neil's lifetime. Just the tools you use, the concepts you have, the way that your epistemologies of knowledge have changed, it's been quite considerable. And it's faster and faster and faster. And as I said, all we can do is give you the mental dexterity to be able to cope with what's coming your way. And that's why we're here. And we have to use whatever tactics come to hand or whatever expertise we have to try and illustrate what the parameters of that future is. So it's not about individuals' vision, it's about the broad scope of the canvas, really. Thank you.